Described as the most beautiful city built by human, Venice is an amazing place full of history and uniqueness. Part of the World Heritage List, the City of Islands is one of the most visited destinations of Europe with its one-of-a-kind surroundings and culture. Though small in area, it once ruled a significant part of the Mediterranean and from architecture to fashion, contributed greatly to world culture. Join me in exploring this wonderful place on whose bridges, canals and squares, history and the present meet. Venice is situated in northeast Italy, at the center of the eponymous lagoon in which there are 62 other islands. Connected to the Adriatic Sea through three inlets, the lagoon is estimated to have formed around 7,000 years ago. These empty islands and swamps in the lagoon may give us some idea on how Venice looked before it was founded. Consisting of the historical city center that resembles a fish when viewed from above and settlements like Mestre and Marghera in the mainland, the city of Venice is also the capital of the Veneto region, one of the 20 administrative divisions of Italy. Formed by 117 islands grouped together, Venice does not have any roads and transportation is realized through more than 170 canals of different sizes. Its fiber, unchanged for centuries, and its environment, unpolluted by automobiles, distinguish Venice from other cities of the world. Set in this unique surrounding, buildings in Venice are built on millions of stakes driven into the ground, specifically 7 or 8 per square meter. Because of the low oxygen in the water, these stakes don't rot and even get harder and harder over the years. Above the stakes, whose object is to stabilize the soft surface that's made up of sand, mud and clay, a layer of stone is laid, on which buildings are constructed. The restoration and replacement of the stakes that were once driven by hand is today carried out by modern machines. Let's briefly go over the city's history. First residents of Venice are believed to be Byzantine citizens of nearby cities escaping from Germanic attacks during the migration period. Foundation of the city is accepted as the 25th of March 421. Venetians chose their first leader, or Doge, in the year 697. Even though the Doge was the highest and most revered person in the city, he could almost never make decisions on his own or even leave the city. Over 1100 years, 117 dogs ruled Venice. In the 8th century, after years of invasion of the Lombards, Venice becomes one of the last remaining pieces of Byzantine soil in Europe. While the Byzantine Empire gradually weakens, in the year 810, Venice successfully holds off Lombards after a six-month-long siege, proving to be a new rising power, and in a few years separates from the empire to become an independent state. In the year 828, two Venetian mercenaries steal the bones of the famed evangelist Saint Mark from his shrine in Alexandria and bring them to Venice. The legend says that they put the bones in a basket and cover them with pork, in order for the basket not to be searched by Egyptians. For the sacred remains, a basilica is built in the main square of the city. Bringing the holy remains of Saint Mark, one of the most revered figures in Christianity, grants Venice a lot of prestige, and Saint Mark is accepted as the patron saint of the city. The winged lion that you can see everywhere in Venice is originally Saint Mark's symbol. Between the 9th and the 12th centuries, Venice turns into a powerful city-state by conquering nearby cities while developing in trade. With the help of relations with both East and West and trade of products such as silk and spice, Republic of Venice becomes the wealthiest state in Europe and expands its territories as far as Cyprus. Controlling the largest fleet of Mediterranean for centuries, Venice had 3,300 ships and 36,000 soldiers at the peak of its power. In the 15th century starts the declining period of the Republic. After losing Thessaloniki to the Ottoman Empire in 1430, Venice sends help to the Byzantine Empire during the siege of Constantinople. As a result, after conquering the city, Mehmet II declares war on Venice, which leads to the loss of a large portion of Mediterranean soil. After the discovery of America and new sea routes from Europe to India, Venice's dominance in trade also regresses sharply. Moreover, the Black Death causes the lives of two-thirds of the city's population between the years 1575 and 1630. Despite all these, in the 18th century, Venice was one of the most refined cities in Europe and had a tremendous reputation in the fields of art and architecture. Among important Venetian figures are Marco Polo, who influenced many other explorers with his journeys to Central Asia and China, Antonio Vivaldi, one of the fathers of the Baroque music, and the popular European socialite and famous Casanova, Giacomo Casanova. In 1797, Napoleon takes over the city, putting an end to the thousand-year-old republic, and the city is handed over to Austria. After the Italian unification in 1866, Venice and the Veneto region becomes a part of the new Italian state and carries on to this day. If you are coming to Venice from a nearby city by train, you will cross the 3.5 kilometers long Independence Bridge and arrive at the St. Lucia train station. Construction of the station started in 1861 and took its final form in 1952. It serves to 450 trains and 82,000 passengers daily. Full with cafes and stores, St. Lucia station has 22 platforms used by national and international trains. Exiting the station and coming across the beautiful Grand Canal will make you love Venice at first sight. And if you're traveling by plane, you can take the shuttle from Venice's airport, named after the famous Venetian explorer Marco Polo, and arrive at Rome Square, the only place in Venice that motorized vehicles can enter. Known also as the bus station of Venice, Rome Square is where you can find buses and taxis to travel to nearby cities and airports, as well as shops selling touristic items such as maps, ferry tickets and city passes. Just like the train station, Rome Square is also connected to the mainland with the Independence Bridge, opened in 1933 by Mussolini. Even though walking is the most common method of transportation in Venice, if you're in a rush or want to visit nearby islands, you can take the ferry, which, with its more than 60 stops, is nothing short of an advanced subway system. With different shapes and sizes, there are more than 400 bridges in Venice. It is of course very hard to talk about all of them, so I'll show you only the four bridges that span over the Grand Canal. First, let's get to know the Grand Canal. It is the longest of the 177 canals of Venice and it divides the city with a shape of a reverse S. It is 3,800 meters long, 5 meters deep, and has a varying width of between 30 and 90 meters. 170 buildings surround its banks, most of which date back to between 13th and the 18th centuries, when Venice was at its richest. Each day, 4,500 boats and ferries cross the canal, along which there are 18 ferry stops. This is one of the newest bridges in Venice. Opened in 2008, the official name of the bridge is Ponte delle Costituzioni, meaning Constitution Bridge. The name was given because of its inauguration on the 60th anniversary of the Italian Constitution, but usually, because of its architect, everyone calls it the Calatrava Bridge. The bridge, designed by the Spanish architect Santiago Calatrava, known for his futuristic works in over 20 countries, is 80 meters long and 7 meters high. With the purpose of connecting the train station with the bus stops of Rome Square, the Constitution Bridge was opened on the west end of the Grand Canal after 8 years of construction. It is also the most debated bridge in Venice, drawing criticism in the following topics. The project's cost of 3 times of its original budget of 4 million euros and maintenance costs of 800,000 euros per year, its proximity to the next bridge on the canal, its modern design, which is out of sync with the classical Venetian architecture, the glass steps that tend to get wet and cause injuries on foggy days, and its openness to erosions and decays. When the bridge was opened, following the criticisms on its lack of wheelchair access, a lift was constructed beside it, which sadly hasn't worked for years. Infamous for over budgets and delays in most of its projects, Calatrava is now being sued by the Venice municipality in multiple cases. Ponte degli Scalzi is the third bridge to be built on the Grand Canal, and it can be said that it's the most modest looking one out of the four. It's made only out of stone and has a simple design, but all things considered, it is a beautiful, humble and adorable bridge. Opened in 1934, the Scalzi Bridge is 40 meters long and 7 meters high. Like most of the bridges in Venice, it was made by the stone produced in the Istria peninsula of today's Croatia. Situated directly in front of the train station, it gets its name from the nearby church of Scalzi, meaning barefoot monks. The district of Rialto, the financial and commercial center of Venice for nearly 1,000 years, houses the most famous bridge in Venice. The first wooden bridge connecting the two sides of the neighborhood, whose name comes from Rivo Alto, meaning high bank, was built in 1181 and collapsed shortly. After the following 3 wooden bridges also went down, Venetians built the stone bridge that we see today. Rialto Bridge was completed in 1591. It is the oldest bridge over the Grand Canal. It is also one of the most popular tourist spots in Venice. All day, tons of people, especially tourists, cross the bridge, often stopping to take photos of this beautiful view. And as you can see, there are some shops on the two sides. They do some shopping here and there. So if one day you'd like to see hundreds of people and be like smothered by them, this is the place you have to come, because it's always crowded as f***. Empty only in the early morning hours, Rialto Bridge is one of the most visited tourist attractions in Venice, along with St. Mark's Square. In terms of photographs taken, the south side of the bridge is one of the most popular spots in Venice, and for a good reason too. This marvelous view. Situated at the heart of trade, the bridge has had jewelry and textile shops since its early days. This makes Rialto Bridge one of the only 5 bridges in the world that have shops on them. From gondolier shirts to jewelry made from Murano glass, you can find lots of touristic items in the shops lined up after the bridge as well. Located at the core of the city, ferry and gondola stops and numerous hotels, cafes and restaurants surround the bridge. And if you enjoy fish, I'd recommend a visit to the renowned fishers market nearby, where you can find many types of Mediterranean fish. Also, cooking your own food at times is a good idea in a pricey city like Venice. Although initially a target for criticism because of its design and thought not to last long, Rialto Bridge has been standing for 400 years and is today one of the globally famous symbols of Venice. Taking its name from the Fine Arts Academy nearby, the Academia Bridge dates back to the year 1854. It is also the only wooden bridge over the Grand Canal. Housing the famous Leonardo da Vinci sketch Vitruvian Man, the Accademia Gallery is one of the most visited museums in Venice. The 48-meter-long bridge was opened a year before that of Scalzi in 1933, replacing an iron one that was built in 1854. As well as being one of the few wooden bridges in Venice, I'm sure it's the only one with a toilet. Having another splendid Venetian view, the bridge draws photograph enthusiasts all the time, and especially at sunrise. In addition to these four bridges, there are 427 more in Venice, and some of them sure have interesting stories. In the 1500s, homosexuality had become so common in Venice that the administration gave permission to prostitutes to advertise themselves by displaying their bodies in certain areas. This is one of those places, the Ponte delle Tette, or Bridge of Titties. In here, usually as a group, ladies of the night used to promote themselves by exhibiting their breasts to gentlemen traveling on the canal and try to collect customers. Both the social and political center of the city throughout its history, St. Mark's Square usually tops the lists of must-see places in Venice. To get to the square, you can follow the signs placed at the majority of streets. One of the most well-known squares in Europe, not all who visit it are human. Here we are at the St. Mark's Square, full of pigeons. It's the heart of the city. If you're in Venice, without doubt you'll also come here. It's the biggest square in Venice, and actually, it's forbidden to feed these pigeons, but everyone finds a way. Ah, hi there. Look, buddy, I can't feed you. Why are you doing this? I mean, I'd like to give you something to eat, but I can't. You know, it's forbidden. The cops could come. You just go now, okay? Yeah, they messed up my hand. Anyway, now let me tell you a little more about this lovely square of St. Mark. Even though it's forbidden by law to feed the crazed pigeons of St. Mark's, street vendors don't seem to care.
No, it's forbidden.
There are even supervisors in the square responsible for taking action in case of someone feeding the birds who seriously damage the historical artifacts in the square. The long buildings surrounding the three sides of the square were where the nine officials responsible for governing the city, called procuratori, used to live and work. The part directly across the basilica was built in 1810 by Napoleon as a palace for himself, and today is used as the entrance of the Correr Museum. The St. Mark's Basilica, which gives the square its name, is without doubt the most striking building in the square and was used as the private chapel of the Doge when it was built in the 11th century. Its importance increasing over time, the basilica was used for public events and ceremonies like the funerals of doges and became the main church of the city. A perfect example of Byzantine architecture, the bright yellow mosaics both inside and outside of the basilica have given it the nickname of the Church of Gold.
Maybe it come from me. It is possible to observe the Byzantine influence on Venetian architecture everywhere in Venice, and especially in St. Mark's Square and the Basilica. Back in the day, lots of pieces were brought here from Istanbul. For example, these two columns behind me and this marble statue are among the works that came here from Istanbul.
This statue, brought to Venice after the sack of Constantinople during the Fourth Crusade, was made 1700 years ago and depicts four Roman generals. The left foot of one of the generals was broken off during the raid and today is on display at the Istanbul Archaeological Museum. The four horses above the entrance of the basilica are also among the works smuggled from Constantinople. Once adorning the Sultanahmet Square, the horses were brought to Paris by Napoleon to be put on a triumphal arch in 1797, but were taken back to Venice 20 years later. They watched over the St. Mark's Square until 1970, when they were moved to the treasury of the basilica and replaced with replicas.
At the corner of the basilica lies its 98-meter-long bell tower, which was completed in 1549. It collapsed in the summer of 1902 because of a big crack at the base and was reconstructed within 10 years. For 8 euros, you can climb to the top floor and enjoy Venice from the highest point possible. Next to the basilica is the palace where dogs lived for 1,000 years. Once home to the richest heads of state in Europe, the palace is among the worth-seeing places in Venice. The court at the east wing of the palace became an origin of one of Venice's many legends. Very close to the square lies one of the must-see places in Venice. This is Ponte dei Sospiri, or the Bridge of Sighs. Legend says that at this side were the courts and at this side jails, and criminals given the death penalty used to take one last look at Venice while they were crossing the bridge and sigh before its beauty. This is how it's named, and so is the common conception, but sadly it is nothing more than just a legend. The famed British poet Lord Byron popularized the story that made the Bridge of Sighs one of the most famous bridges in Venice. In reality, in the year 1600, when the bridge was built, death sentences were almost never given, and criminals who served life sentences did not stay at this part of the jail. Besides, not much can be seen from the tiny gaps on the bridge anyway. St. Mark's Square is ideal for those who feel like escaping from Venice's narrow streets. All day long, live music plays in the square, which is home to world-famous cafes. A charming cafe watching the square. This is Cafe Florian. It is the oldest coffee shop in Venice and even in Italy. It was founded in 1720, which means soon it will turn 300. And to be honest, its prices are worthy of its history. For example, if you'd like an espresso that's normally sold for 1 euro, here you have to pay 7.5. Regardless of their prices, Café Florian has an important place in Venice's history. For instance, during the independence war against Austria, it served both as an important meeting place for commanders and a health center for the wounded. In my opinion, St. Mark's Square should be enjoyed in late night hours. Not a soul would be left in this enormous square, and you can just sit down, enjoy the tranquility, and appreciate the square as long as you like. And best of all, you don't have to order anything to sit at the cafe tables. Tourism, the most important source of income of Venice, has also become the city's biggest problem. Besides the contribution of annual flow of 20 million tourists to the city's economy, its negative aspects are on the rise, primarily on the environment. Local population is worried about the damages to the ecosystem of the city and the lagoon by the increasing ferry transportation and cruiser ships. With its narrow streets and area of about 6 square kilometers, it is a fact that Venice does not have the capacity to host this many people. It is also the main reason why the 2/3 of the population has left the city, which in 1950 had 175,000 residents. In the window of a pharmacist in St. Bartholomew Square near the Rialto Bridge is placed a digital sign that shows the actual population of Venice. Its local population at 56,000, Venice draws 60,000 tourists each day. Demographers believe that unless a measure is set in tourist numbers to balance the delicate structure of the city, no local resident will be left in Venice by 2030, and the city will have become something of a theme park where people come in the morning and leave at night. Talking about tourists, dating back to the year 1162 when people gathered in St. Mark's Square to celebrate a victory, the Carnival of Venice draws 3 million of them to the city each year.
During the month-long carnival, streets of Venice gets packed with Venetians donning both dresses reflecting Venetian and Italian history and costumes with modern designs. The carnival is the origin of another famous symbol of the city. Aside from costumes, many different types of masks have also been used throughout the carnival's history and have come to be an important part of the Venetian culture. Some of these masks, which you can find in almost any shop that sells touristic items, are not hand-painted and are manufactured from poor quality material, so they have low prices of between 10 and 20 euros. Better quality masks produced by artisans, some of whom have been making masks for generations, are higher in prices but also worth the money because of their endurance and variety of models. Another example of well-known symbols of Venice is the gondola, used by thousands of tourists each day to explore the city from a different perspective. The design and purpose of the gondola have evolved over the last 800 years. First gondolas were shorter and lower than those of today, and they had a small cabin called felze. They were used for transportation and in ceremonies like weddings, and there were around 10,000 of them. Today there are 400 gondolas which are used solely for touristic purposes. Made out of 8 different types of wood, a gondola consists of 280 pieces put together. The left side of a gondola is a little longer than its right side, the purpose of which being to avoid the gondola to steer to the left when propelled by the gondolier who stands on the right. Every gondola in Venice that's used for tourism has the same prow. It serves to balance the gondolier's weight and is full of symbols. The top side of the head represents the traditional hat worn by dogs. The S-shaped body takes its form from the Grand Canal. The 6 forward-pointing prongs under the head represent the 6 districts of Venice and the backward-pointing one, the island of Giudecca. Regarded among the most romantic activities in the world, the prices of a gondola trip are determined by the city council and vary between 80 and 100 euros, depending on the duration. Prices go a little higher for those who'd like to take the trip at night. One of the things that you can't see anywhere but Venice is the submerging of the city as a result of the rising lagoon water in certain months of the year. This phenomenon, called acqua alta, meaning high water, originates when the water, which is already high because of the moon's effect on tides, comes together with the Sirocco wind that blows from the southeast along the Adriatic and is usually seen in November and February. St. Mark's Square is one of the places where water rises the most. When the square turns into a giant pool, it gets packed with people sporting pairs of waterproof boots. For those who don't wish to get wet, pedestrian traffic flows on the wooden platforms laid out by the municipality on highly used streets. To say a thing or two about this flooded square of St. Mark's, the water is very cold. I'm guessing around 1 or 2 degrees. And normally the lagoon's water tends to be very dirty, but it looks clean today, so I can walk in it without worries. I mean, if the water was higher, I'd probably even swim in it, but... And now the sun is shining. Sea and sun. What more could you want? Hope my butt don't get wet though. Even though it's all good and fun for the tourists, with the hundreds of thousands of euros in damages that comes along with it, acqua alta does not amuse the local population at all. Setups to prevent flooding such as this one can be seen in front of numerous households and shops. Sadly, some of them can't escape the water. A few hours before the water rises, warning sirens are heard all across the city. First comes an alarm to grab attention, followed by sirens that indicate how high the water will rise in accordance with the number of tones played. Each tone means the water will be 10 centimeters higher than the normal level.
this year's water level is not that high compared to previous records. Here on the wall of Venice's City Hall, we can see that the highest aqua altas are marked. It was this high in 1916, in 36, in 51, and in the great flood of 1966, we see that the water was this high.
Venice was hit by the worst flood of its history on November 4, 1966. 16,000 houses were abandoned after the occasion. Today, several buildings in Venice carry signs that show the water level of that day.
This year, in 2014, water must have been about this high, according to my calculations. Of course, St. Mark's Square shouldn't mislead us. Since it's the lowest point in the city, water there is higher than normal.
The tides that cause aqua alta are separated by 6 hours. The water is at its highest at around 10 a.m. and 10 p.m. and lowers down in a couple of hours. A 7 billion euro project named Moses is carried out to help protect the lagoon, whose average water level has risen by 24 centimeters over the last century. The idea is to set up rows of mobile gates at the three inlets of the lagoon, which temporarily separate it from the sea in the event of a high tide. The project is expected to be completed by 2016. For such a small city, one might think there aren't many options for sports and outdoor activities, but Venice proved this wrong. It has its own professional soccer team and even an annual marathon. The Venice Marathon has been carried out on the last Sunday of October since 1985. 8,000 runners start the marathon from a small village named Stra in the mainland, and 40 kilometers later, they cross the Grand Canal on a specially built bridge before going around to St. Mark's Square. After the square, the marathoners go along the sea and cross another 7 bridges, which lead them to the finish line. The marathon record is set at 2 hours 8 minutes and 13 seconds for men and at 2 hours 23 minutes and 37 seconds for women. The winner of 2014's marathon was the Ethiopian Behailu Mamo with his time of 2 hours 16 minutes and 45 seconds.
This part is for shopping enthusiasts. Let's see what's there to buy when you come to Venice, types of souvenirs, masks and fashion items and stuff like that. I'm shooting at night because in the daytime, shop owners usually berate me for taking videos of their commodities.
Most popular souvenirs in Venice are glass products and masks. As I mentioned before, handmade masks have a vast range of models. Some shops even take your order and create a mask just as you want. Glassmaking has developed in the northern island of Murano since the 7th century, and the best quality products are still manufactured there. They are, of course, handmade, which means they're priced accordingly. Like every other city in Italy, it's possible to see very fashionable items in the windows. There are many stores of high-end clothing brands, especially on the streets to the west of the St. Mark's Square. It is best to visit Venice between November and February. The weather may be rainy at times, but believe me, it is better than the summer heat. Besides, it's not that crowded. So we've seen many places to go to, but one of the most enjoyable things you can do here in Venice is to just walk around. It is a lot different than the cities we're used to, so everything seems interesting and beautiful. And my advice to you, do not leave Venice without seeing its unique sunset. The 1600-year-old Queen of the Adriatic will always be waiting for you with all there is to do and to see. So, bon voyage!
Sempre tutta quanta la verità, almeno quella che tu vuoi sentirti dire. Allora cominciamo a vedere cosa c'è nel tuo futuro. Tra i segni del destino intravedo chiaramente una vita tutta quanta in chiaro scuro. E di sicuro non ci sarà mai la ricchezza, però vedo che possiedi almeno una moneta d'oro per pagare il